I'm Dave Sandell.
And I'm Caleb Gardner.
And this is Best Album For, a podcast where we talk about the best album for listening to music in the first half of 2023. Caleb, how has the first half of 2023 gone for you?
On several dimensions, Dave. It's been good. It's been good.
Hey, we have officially launched. Obviously, we recorded several of these ahead of our launch. And even this one, we're recording a couple weeks before it's actually going to come out. But we have officially launched this podcast. We've gotten such great feedback. I really appreciate everybody who's listening and following along with us. I've definitely heard some fun potential topics for us to do.
Oh, yes.
Had a couple best albums thrown my way, which was fun. Hearing from a lot of different people who are really vibing with this, which is really fun. And so just, you know, want to thank everybody. Please, of course, share this with your friends and subscribe and leave us a positive review. If you're willing to, it really, really helps us get to keep doing this.
I love that you've gotten people throwing what their best album for that scenario would be. We should start collecting those and doing, like, you know, highlights of what other people chose for that topic. That'd be really fun.
We're definitely going to have to revisit some of our episodes at some point, like do a 6-month review or something where we invite some people on to tell us how we got it totally wrong, either with the album or with the topic, you know, just our ideas about the topic.
Yeah.
Yep.
That's a fun idea.
Today we're going to have a little bit of a different format than what we've done the past several episodes, because we wanted to take a minute and talk about our favorite music we've heard so far this year. And so, of course, we're talking about the best albums, plural, for listening to music in the first half of 2023, January through June. Again, we're recording this kind of halfway through June, and so there's some stuff still coming out in the next mm-hmm. couple weeks that we are bummed we won't be able to hear and consider. But I think this will be a good list nonetheless.
I mean, I had real anxiety about that when things were like coming out and I'm like picking my list. I was like, oh God, could this make it? And then I'm like trying to go back and listen to things I forgot to listen to and like trying to be as comprehensive. It's a lot of pressure you've put on us, Dave.
It's true. It's true. I make lists as a way to relax. And so I didn't feel quite as much pressure as I felt like extraordinary opportunity to finally do something semi-useful with this massive waste of time that I seem to not be able to shake.
Yeah, I mean, I do that too, but it's usually about revenge.
You know, so you have like, a notebook like, of people you need revenge on? How many people are on that list?
Yeah. Have you seen Kill Bill? Do I need to explain the plot of Kill Bill right now for you?
For the audience, I think you should.
It's sort of like that.
Wow. So you just cross them off freehand as you get your revenge?
Big marker style. Yeah, definitely.
Oh, remind me to put down on our list best album for getting revenge. Or best album for crossing off having gotten revenge.
Yes.
Those are two meaty topics that other people can relate to.
Two podcasts. One is the satisfaction of having gotten revenge.
This took a turn. I want to know everything. Let's just put this one on hold and talk about who's on your list. Name names. All right.
So great,
let's
teacher.
Just take a step back. As you've thought about your experience of listening to music this year, what stands out to you? Like what are some themes from this year that have really stood out to you?
I mean, the biggest one for me, I think, is probably how many good R&B and folk albums came out at the first half of this year, which is funny because like I struggled with which ones I wanted to make in the actual list versus kind of our honorable mentions. And I really struggled with it because there were so many good albums.
Yeah.
And neither of those genres, this is a wild thing, neither of those genres are ones I reach for. Like I don't typically do folk. I don't typically do R&B. I think we talked about this a few pods ago where like those will be tracks that will make, you know, like my track list. I keep like best of 2023 track lists and we'll listen to that playlist. And R&B and folk are frequently featured on that, but the entire album, very rarely. So the fact that there were several really great R&B albums, several really great folk albums this year that I was like debating making it into my top five already was significant.
Yeah, I'm actually, there's about, well, I guess there are three, maybe four records on my top five list that it's hard to believe won't be on my top five list in December. Like, this has been a really quality year for music. And I don't, sometimes I get to the end of the year and I struggle to complete a top five, even a top, you know, 10, top 10 for sure. top 10 for sure, but sometimes even a top 5 can be a struggle. And this year it was no sweat. I have noticed that women are killing it. Like 95% of my favorite albums and my honorable mentions are all made by women. I think I have 15 records on kind of my long list so far this year of things that I've genuinely loved. And I think 13 of those are made by women. And one by a non-binary person. I mean, it's just been a great year for women in music, man. They're killing it.
Yeah. I didn't even think about that, but you're right. 2/3 of my list is the same.
Yeah.
Yeah. Crazy.
Well done. Well done.
Yes. Women. Two white guys celebrate you.
For real though. I mean, it's just awesome. It's a nice, I look at my, you know, my like kind of historical list and I always feel like, boy, this is a lot really heavy on men. Especially, you know, as lead singers.
Yeah.
And you know, part of that is just, you know, probably something on my part. But another part of that is that women haven't always gotten the same opportunities as men. And it's sure. easier for men, you know, bands fronted by men to get signed.
Yeah.
Blah, blah, blah. And so it's
patriarchy, et cetera, et cetera.
Right, right. And so this is a cool moment. Feels like. Most of the good music that's being made right now is being made by women, and that's only positive.
I agree, especially Black women. I mean, every one of my both R&B and folk best like albums this year, I think, were made by Black women. Several Black queer women, like just really, really good.
Good stuff, man. Good music.
Yeah.
Anything else stand out to you before we jump into our lists?
I guess I was watching an interview by Caroline Polachek recently, who's on my honorable mentions list with her album. And she mentioned like genre basically isn't a thing. It's a thing we made up. Genre doesn't exist anymore. Do you believe that? Like, this is why the reason I'm thinking about it is I'm like, oh, I never had R&B. Oh, I never had folk. But, you know, now that I think about it, I've always had flavors of those things mixed into things that I've listened to or like vice versa. Do you even think about genre anymore when you're pulling up music?
That's really interesting. I think I do because I just historically have been trained to do so. Like, you know, for a long time, people got signed because they fit into a genre.
Mm-hmm.
And with the invention of the internet, you know, everything has been so dispersed. Like, you know, they say that it's hard to find many new bands that can fill an arena or can headline a Super Bowl or whatever else.
Right.
But that doesn't mean there's not thousands of amazing bands. Whereas before, maybe there were tons of bands who could fill an arena, but that was it. There was like only a handful of other bands. And so there's just such a wide breadth of music that we have access to all the time. And it's easier for me to listen to all of it. I don't have to pay, you know, money to listen to every album in the era of streaming.
Yeah.
So I suppose I still listen for genre. I guess I feel, you know, there's so much music that's coming out all the time that I have to have some kind of litmus test. You know, neither of us do this for a living. And so we don't get to sit around and listen to records all day, every day, despite what I wish I could do for a living. I really miss my calling, man. So, you know, when like Pitchfork gives something a really high grade, I'll listen to it. You know, like if they say, hey, yeah, this is a record you should hear, like they give it the best new music tag, I will always listen to that. But if they don't give it something that tag, I'll still look at their reviews. And if something gets a high mark in a genre that I like, then I'll always check that out. And if something gets a high mark in a genre I don't historically like, then sometimes I'll skip that unless it bubbles up again, you know, in six different places.
Yeah.
And so I think I still pay attention to genre, but I guess I have to agree that genre is, I mean, it's so much more fluid than it's ever been before.
Yeah, it's at least not as useful as it was when we were growing up, right? Like, yes, you're right. I think executives said, oh, rap metal is being listened to a lot. Let's sign some more rap right. metal bands.
Right.
And that's how those kinds of things become a wave and not just like a one-off, you know, band.
Well, and just the dearth of radio, you know, like,
yeah, that is
radio stations totally. Were formatted based on a certain genre.
Well, and there's not a scarcity problem anymore. So people can try. They can try on all kinds of genres, see what fits. Whereas you and I had a scarcity problem about like if I buy the CD, then I can't buy other CDs.
Right.
So I have to be really sure that this is the kind of music that I'm going to resonate with. And now that created an identity with genre. I think we don't have now as much.
Yeah, I think I agree with that. I also it's probably true that people have access to so much music now that new artists coming up have significantly varied influences. Whereas, yeah, you know, maybe if I was picking up a guitar and starting a band after hearing Velvet Underground or after hearing McCluskey or after hearing, you know, My Bloody Valentine, whatever band that was kind of a cult little band, like, you wouldn't necessarily also be listening to Stevie Wonder. And there was a long time where, you know, bands who were kind of doing rock, but with Stevie Wonder's, you know, worldview or you know, his ear for melody or whatever else, that was notable. Like, that was a, hey, this is sort of a take on this genre and this genre kind of being mashed together in a really new and fun way.
Yeah.
Whereas now it feels almost like everything's out there. I guess so. Yeah. But now it feels like everything is just up for grabs and you have a million influences and you're trying to
Put
them all together.
I didn't even think about that. Like, we're really in the kind of second generation of effects of the internet on music, in that the people who grew up with streaming, and you're right, access to so many different artistic influences, are now making music themselves. Yeah, that's a fascinating paradigm to think about.
Did you have, when you were a kid, did you have a skateboard or a guitar case or something that had a ton of stickers on it?
I did have a guitar case. Yeah, why?
Did you fill it with stickers? Like, did you fill it with bands that you liked?
Having stickers on your guitar case assumes that you are taking your guitar somewhere, and I was not that cool.
Fair enough.
And I was definitely not cool enough to have a skateboard. By any means. I would have fell on my ass easily.
That's what I did with my skateboard. Never got better. I didn't get to have that, you know, that kind of quintessential skateboard filled with stickers. But when I see those kind of online, they're always filled with the same genres of bands. Like, people, including me, used to just listen to, you know, if we liked one thing, we would listen to 20 other things that sounded like that. Whereas now I don't really do that. I haven't done that for a very long time, but, you know, I'm very open to every genre in a way that feels sometimes annoying because there's just so much music, both new and historically. But I wonder, you know, if you would look at somebody's skateboard today, if it'd be filled with lots of different influences.
It's a great illustration of how, like, the genre being associated with identity. And I think when I was growing up, genre was definitely an identity that people held very strongly. And I was always kind of like atypical in that I loved all kinds of music and felt self-conscious about it. You know, like, all my friends are listening to Nirvana and I'm over here with Boys to Men's too. I'm like, I'm not gonna learn, you know, like, but I just loved, to your point, like, I just loved all kinds of music. And I think it wasn't until later, maybe my high school years, where I really tried to almost force myself into that identity of liking one particular kind of music. Hmm. Went down a rabbit hole of that, of the, like, here's who I want to be and here's the music associated with that. And then that lasted for really only a few years. And then back in college, I was just like, I don't care anymore. I'm going to listen to whatever I want.
Yeah. It's the way to be, man. Listen to whoever you want.
Yeah, totally. Be whoever All right. you want.
So should we jump into these lists?
For sure.
So these are, we both put together top five lists, five records in some sort of quasi order of albums that we love this year. How did you think about making your list?
I mean, I think that I mostly just picked albums that I really loved. I tried to be a little cognizant of the reviews they got too, but, like, I mean, to your point about there being so much music, there was a ton of music that got great reviews that I didn't really resonate with. And so, of course, I'm not going to pick that. So I think I mainly was just like, what are my top five albums of the first half of this year? So I approached it like that.
Yep. I essentially did the same thing. I very rarely at this point have an eye towards what is being critically adored. Although things that are being critically adored bubble up and I end up listening to them and loving much of it.
Yeah, I think that's right. Things that are critically adored, I will give a listen to. Like, if, you know, like you said, shows up on Pitchfork best albums list, I'll be like, all right, I'll listen to that. Unless I know it's like a super experimental or whatever, like, out of left field thing that I know I'm not going to like just because I know what kind of music it is.
Yeah, absolutely. But I think that I, at this point, am just giving a list of here are the five records that I loved. And to that point, I actually think that my number one record this year is maybe not as, like, I don't, maybe this isn't true actually, but I guess what I want to say is it's maybe not the most critically acclaimed album of the year by any stretch of the imagination, but it is the one that I have most enjoyed. And so it went to number one, nice. Even though there's my number two is probably one of the more like adventurous. I've never heard anything like this. This is amazing music. So well, it'll be fun to talk through all that stuff with you. So let's go in order, 5 through 1. We'll kind of take turns, alternate. I think if we shared something, there's a couple albums that we shared, we'll hold off until the person who has it ranked a little higher, and then we'll both just get to talk about it. So should we jump in?
Yeah, let's do it.
My number 5 album for the first half of 2023 is a really idiosyncratic pick. That I don't know if any of you are going to like it, but man, it is so fun. It is called ULTRAKUNST, and it is by Brutalismus 3000. I have no idea what that title means. It could be a swear word. I could be saying something really unfortunate, but here we are.
Just offended our entire German audience, Dave.
Yes. This is a electroclash hyperpop band from Germany. Their lyrics are in German and English and I think French and Slovak, I've read. And they are just making really amazing, fun, poppy techno music. But it is a little noisy. It's a little like grinding on your ears. Like, it kind of reminds me of like Sleigh Bells, but even more intense. But I just really love their energy. Every time I put it on, I light up and I get so excited that I'm listening to it. And the truth is that I don't often make it more than halfway through the record before I'm like, I need a little break. But man, when I'm in that first half of the record, it is so fun. And there's probably a couple albums that maybe I should have in my number 5 spot based on what I've loved this year. But I just really want to shout these guys out because they are doing something really unique and fun and bright. And I hope more people will check them out. So the song I'd tell you to start with is called... Nope, I'm not going to get this right. I'm just going to say the title that I'm going to pronounce wrong. It's called Je n'existe pas.
I thought that entire English phrase was the name of the song, and you were just translating it because it was like one long German word.
Yes, that makes sense. Most of this music is not in English. In fact, when English pops up on this record, it's like, oh, it's I think I understood that.
What's weird is
I really love this record.
The song that you just said was, it's in French. And it's Je n'existe pas.
Je n'existe pas?
Yeah. And it means I don't exist. I don't know why. I don't know why it means that.
Well, there you go. did you listen to this at all?
I did, yeah. After you
is this
it
for
to
you?
Me. No, not usually. however...
Okay.
I see the appeal. Like when you were talking about it, like grinding, and like I was playing it loud in my office, and it was fun. I get it. Like, I see the appeal for sure.
I feel like if I am really struggling to get going in the morning, like this is a good album for get my butt out of bed and work out. Like, do something with my day that is important and useful, instead of kind of having a slow morning where, oh my gosh, it's already 10 o'clock and we haven't barely gotten started yet. This is a good record for probably long road trips. If you just need a burst of energy halfway through it, you know, if you are driving around town doing grocery shopping and you just need a quick burst of caffeine, this is a great one.
Maybe if you don't have caffeine, you put this in instead.
This
is your audio caffeine.
This is your audio caffeine. These guys are probably bound to perform late in the day at Coachella at some point and put on an amazing show. Really excited about this band. Looking forward to more of it in the future. And also, if you don't like it, I get it.
Yeah,
it's really idiosyncratic.
You know, the nice thing about Best Album 4 is it's accessible. You know, it's all like music that you can immediately just...
you know, we'll put this stuff in the show notes, but Brutalismus 3000.
Yeah.
Because that one, people aren't going to hold on to that in their head. This is not a normal name for a band.
Brutalismus being the German version of Christmas. Right?
I don't know. Oh, okay. You're making a joke.
Of course I am.
Well, you knew Zen is his ball. So Maybe you also speak fluent German. Yeah.
Well, I have a French wife. That helps with that one.
Anyway. No, that's fair. Caleb, what is your number five?
My number five, I'm going to go a different direction, but also a little off the wall. I'm going to go with an album from Little... excuse me, not Little. There's no consonants in there. Lil Yachty called Let's Start Here. And I'm going to be honest with you, before this album, Lil Yachty was not on my radar as any kind of thing that I listened to. And also, like, what I realized is that I have not enjoyed a full rap album in a long time. Like, the genre has lost its allure a little bit for me. I don't know if it's because I don't, like, find a lot of people out there, like, making really good kind of experimental, like pushing the boundaries of the genre, or maybe we've lost some of the social commentary. I honestly couldn't tell you, but it just hasn't, I haven't found anything that's resonated with me in a while. And this, I think, resonated with me because of its genre boundary pushing sensibilities. I mean, if you are fans of psych rock combined with R&B and hip hop, this is the album for you. If you're fans of 7 minute long guitar solos while someone talks over them, this album is also for you. It's just like, it's weird. It's fun. It's experimental, especially for hip hop, which just like sometimes just feels like repetitive. Oh God, we're talking about the same thing. Do you know what I mean? Like, absolutely. Yeah, the beat's cool, yeah. But are we really, we're just covering the same fucking ground, you know? But this one, I would point you to track 8, Drive Me Crazy. Imagine me circling through life without a piece of you. This is fun. Like, number 9, I've officially lost vision! ! Like, there's just, I love also when like artists just have fun with their track list. Anyway, it's wonderful. It's weird. I did not expect to be suggesting Lil Yachty, but here I am.
Yeah, I'm into it. I like this record a lot. I haven't listened to it a ton. I was glad when you put it on your list, because it gave me an excuse to go back and give it a listen, because I thought when it came out, this album's going to sound really good during the summertime.
Yeah.
And so here we are. And lo and behold, it does sound very good in the summertime.
Definitely great. Like, if you're outside, you want to put something on, you're just like lounging around on your deck, this would be fun.
Absolutely. Cool. Should we move on to our number 4?
Yes.
We share a number 4. I got to admit, I thought this record was going to be a lot higher on my list.
And so did I. I thought in terms of being on higher on your list.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's only because there are 4 amazing records. I really like Brutalismus 2000, and there's a couple honorable mentions that I'll get into later that I really liked. But these next 4 records are more or less interchangeable for me as far as what I've loved the most this year. So it's the degree of you know, disparity between them is small. So our shared number 4, Caleb, do you want to tell them?
Yes, it is The Record by boygenius, an album that we both anticipated a lot, I think. Mm-hmm. Really into the first tracks that were released, really big Phoebe Bridgers fans. Were you fans of Julian Baker and Lucy Dacus very much before this album?
I'm actually surprised that you aren't a huge Julian Baker person, only because Julian Baker has a pretty deep connection to Frightened Rabbit. So Julian Baker covered one of their songs on the charity record that they put out. She also used to cover stuff, you know, live in her concerts. She has a print of Scott on her. So really? For listeners who don't know, Frightened Rabbit is kind of Caleb and I's shared favorite band. Like, that's a band that you and I have experienced together a lot and really love together. And so she really loves Scott, and it seems like he's had some influence on her. So I got into Julie Baker a long time ago, and I think all of her music is really amazing, worth checking out. So if you haven't done a deep dive, I think you'll find a lot to like.
There you go. Great side note.
Lucy Dacus, her last record was high on my year-end list whenever it came out. But I wouldn't say that I have been like following her career quite as closely as Phoebe Bridgers or Julian Baker. Were you into either of them?
Not really. No, I mean, I think they were on my, again, like occasionally we put out a song and I would be like, oh, this is awesome, and make a playlist, but definitely nothing to the extent of like deep diving like I did with Phoebe Bridgers.
For sure. This is probably the like first super group that I can remember where I think that they are all equally matched. Like, these are three amazing artists who are making music that is a little similar, but that really like complements each other well. And as best I can tell, this record was written, you know, while all of them were having big success with their solo careers. So I don't know how much of it was written together versus like, you know, one person would come up with a song and pass it on to her friends and they would, you know, add things to it. It seems like that's true. It seems like whoever is the lead vocalist on each song was kind of the author of that song. And it sounds more or less like their catalog. So I was really surprised how coherent this album was. Like, it's really, it's gorgeous, you know, start to finish. It has a really interesting energy start to finish. They feel like a real band. Like, they don't feel 100%. Like a supergroup trying to do something like that combines all their strengths in like, you know, Mighty Morphin Power Rangers, you know, way. Like, they sound like a real band that I would anticipate having more records from them. You know, they've obviously had their EP a few years ago that I liked, but I wouldn't say that I liked it as much as their solo output. I like this just as much as all of their solo output.
Yeah, I was actually, I'm usually very skeptical on anything resembling a supergroup.
Yeah,
like sure, maybe with the exception of the Kanye and Jay-Z album that we have already discussed at length. Like, it just usually ends up diminishing, I think, everyone involved in terms of it just being not as good as their like solo work. And I agree. I think this was up there for sure.
Yeah. $20 is my favorite track on this record. There's a section at the end of $20 where Phoebe Bridgers, so that's a Julian Baker song, I believe. But there's a section at the end where Phoebe Bridgers is just screaming at the top of her lungs. And it is so invigorating. And it's, I love that moment. I love that song.
That's the one, that's the part of the song where I'm playing it around the house and my kids start going, what are we listening to?
Your kids, man. Your kids need an education in music. Oh,
God. Loosen up.
What's going on, man? Kids?
I was gonna pick between $20 or Not Strong Enough. I am not strong enough to be your man. I try, I can't stop staring at the sea. But I think they're both solid entry points.
Yeah, Leonard Cohen's a great track in this record. We could kind of list every song because they're all really, really good. I watched their live show when they were streaming it on Coachella, and they seem like they're having so much fun together. All the promo and press around this record, they seem like they're having so much fun together. They seem like genuinely close friends who get to do something that they love together, and they're bringing out something really special for each other. So I, you know, when I first heard this record, I thought this was going to be my number one, and it just happens to be number four because there are three records that I like just a little bit more, but I'll be listening to this for years to come.
Nice.
Do you have any sense of what the best situation is to listen to an album like The Record by Boy Genius?
Yeah. The best situation for listening to The Record is hanging out with your teenage girlfriends and deciding that you are all going to make your own supergroup and that boys are stupid.
Wow. Relatable. That sounds accurate, and also I can see why you like it. That sounds right up your alley, Caleb.
You know, Phoebe Bridgers starts screaming and everyone starts screaming along with her, and it's an empowerment moment, really.
Absolutely. I think that like all Phoebe Bridgers projects, this one plays really well at night under an open sky, either on the road or just sitting still. If you find yourself in that situation, you will not be sorry for queuing up The Record. Let's go on to your number three, Caleb.
Yes. My number three for this year so far is All of This Will End by Indigo D'Souza, which I think I brought up. I was listening to quite a bit a few weeks back, and I was anticipating pretty hard because I've got a huge artistic crush on Indigo D'Souza that I have for a few years. And again, I don't know, like, this is one of those I acknowledge, like, I get that for some reason this really resonates with me and other people might think it's just okay. You know?
Yep.
But I there's a few things that are just so appealing to me. One is she's got this super appealing voice that she can flex into all kinds of different situations. Mm-hmm. Like she can be soft with it, she can be loud with it, she can be screaming or like rough, but she can also be very delicate. I love that. Her lyrics are always so accessible and so like immediately relatable. Like she does not, very rarely I would say, does she try to be esoteric or like atmospheric with like what she's talking about. No, she's talking about like going to the supermarket, you know, like she you can immediately relate to the stories that she is telling through her music. And it's just like, I don't know how to describe it other than like nihilistic in a fun way. I don't know. Like, okay. I mean, it's literally called All of This Will End. It's the name of the album. You know, like it's got tracks like Losing and Time Back and Smog. I mean, like it just ends with this like really delicate, nostalgic reflection of a song that I've had on repeat all year called Younger and Dumber, which is very like piano driven. Probably yeah. Be the entry point, I would say. It's got this great build that just starts off really yeah. slow, and it gets into this really powerful emotional moment, and it's a song to her younger self. Like if you hear her like singing back and like being nostalgic yeah. about where she's coming from, I just really love it. But like pair that with, you know, like some songs that are super poppy, some songs that are really grungy. Like she really does this great job of going in between kind of like a more indie pop sound and a more kind of grunge alternative sound. And again, mm-hmm. in a way that, you know, I just really love. And all her album covers are artistic and weird, and I'm into it.
So I actually thought this was going to be your number one. You talk very lovingly about Indigo D'Souza. Like, I think I you don't have to agree with this. Is she your favorite artist right
she
now?
She might be my favorite current artist. That's yeah, I mean, it's definitely hard to say, like, I mean, you know, this is why we make lists. We have sure. a hard time picking right. I mean, just one of favorite that, of anything. Again, exactly. Exactly. I don't know. That's a good question. I know she's up there. For sure.
Yeah, you talk about her very lovingly. It's been fun, yeah. like seeing how excited you've been about this record all year.
Yes,
I like this record. I want to love it with the love of 100 Calebs, but it hasn't quite grabbed me the same way. But I'm going to keep coming back to it because it's really, you know, it's accomplished and it is. There's a lot going on. There's a lot worth revisiting. I found yeah. that every time that I've listened to it again, I found something new to discover, something new to love. And so that's an album worth revisiting all year. But man, Caleb, she's your girl.
Yeah. I really want to see her live this year. I'm trying to get to, she's not coming to Chicago, which I'm very bummed about, but she's coming like around. She's going to like St. Louis and Detroit.
I mean, it makes sense since Chicago's, you know, only the third biggest market in America.
Yeah.
So
no, we talked about this. We get screwed by Lala and Pitchfork and all these big festivals because sure. these people will be like, "Oh, well, that's my time in Chicago."
Oh, is she playing one of those?
I think she is. Oh, I think there she you is. Go. I don't remember yeah, which one.
Hard. Well, because there's yeah. this contract issues. Like she's not allowed to play.
That, yeah.
Like exactly. I saw who was it? Was it the 1975? They put out a tour. I don't really care about 1975 all that much, but they put out sure. a tour for the fall, like a list of dates. And there's a date. I think I'm getting this right. There's a date sometime in like November where the day before they're in like Wisconsin and the day after they're in like Indiana or Minnesota or something. But it says like TBA. And it's like, well, yeah, because you're headlining Lollapalooza. So you can't say that you're also coming back to Chicago, you know, in right. November. But clearly yes. you're coming back to Chicago in November. That's yeah. funny. My number three is, I actually briefly considered making this my number one. I love this record. But I feel like I just need to spend a lot more time with it before I can say that, you know, I listened to it a lot when it came out and then I kind of lost track of it for a minute. And then when I was revisiting things, I was like, oh, this is really good. So it's a band called Wednesday. It is notable that there is a huge TV show right now called Wednesday happening at the same time, and that is probably
confusing. That's not good SEO.
It is not good SEO. And it's actually hard to like do research on Wednesday because you have to get through a lot of other things, including the date, including it's just kind of a bad SEO. So this is a band called Wednesday that has nothing to do with the Netflix hit TV show. The album is called Rat Saw God. And this is a, I don't know how to best describe it other than like, it sounds a little bit like shoegazy and also alt country. Like there are deep, like My Bloody Valentine, influences, but it is at the end of the day, kind of a singer-songwriter indie band. So the lead singer and the singer-songwriter is Carly Hartzman. And she is just one of my favorite singers. She has this quality that I really like in a lot of stuff that's come out over the last several years, like Big Thief and some others, where she doesn't have quite a strong enough voice to hit the music she's writing for herself well. And so in some sense, that sounds like it would be a bad experience, but I actually find it to be this really plaintive, emotive, like really exciting experience of you are having to give all of yourself over to this music to even get close to hitting the notes that you've written for yourself to perform. There's this thing she does where, you know, she'll take a breath in the middle of like a long sustained run, or she'll, you know, she'll kind of not quite hit the notes that she's going for. And for some reason, it just melts me. Like, I feel like this woman is bearing it all and leaving it all on the field. I don't want to make a sports analogy right now, but she is just putting all of herself out there, and her lyrics are very interesting. I read somewhere that this is the first record that she's made that sounds the way she wanted it to sound in her head. And I thought that was pretty cool because there's a lot of building and a lot of like kind of big, almost anthemic, like rock songs. You know, kind of folksy songs as well. I really, really like this group. So she is also her longtime boyfriend, I assume, partner, is MJ Lenderman, who also has put out a lot of really amazing records over the last several years. And they're just making amazing music together.
It's funny that you compared them to Big Thief, because that was what I was like. They did feel like if Big Thief had a baby with My Bloody Valentine.
Yeah.
Right?
That's, for sure.
I feel like that's a great way to describe them. And I will admit, I was not that into this. Like, it was on a bunch of people's like best albums lists when it came out. It got a lot of critical praise, so I gave it a shot, and I just didn't find it that accessible. I was like, you know, I just couldn't find an entry point. And then you were like, no, give it another shot. And then I put it back on, and it definitely took me a few listens, but after a while I was like, okay, I get the appeal. Like, I like this.
I was wondering. I tried to avoid asking you what you thought, since your initial assessment of I don't like this.
No, I don't know that it would make my end of the year list. Yep. But I definitely would put it on again.
If this ends up being the album that I listen to most this year, I wouldn't be shocked. I really like this record. So did I even say the name of this record? It's called Rat Saw God.
You did.
There is a song called Turkey Vultures that I really love. I love every song on this record, but Turkey Vultures is kind of the one that, you know, as I was listening to it, I was like, oh, you're doing something really exciting, and it's really getting me. So
definitely one of the most fun, for sure.
Yeah, it has this fun build. It kind of switches the rhythm halfway through, and that's a neat moment. It's not just a normal kind of crescendo that you'd hear in most rock songs. Mm-hmm. Dig it. I hope they keep making awesome music for years to come.
Also, my actual next one is a band named Tuesday. So just like weirdly,
oh, but not
weirdly
Thursday.
Coincidental. Huh. No, they're too experimental for me.
All right, what is your number two?
My number two is an artist I'm super excited about. Kara Jackson released maybe my favorite folk album of the year. And I wouldn't be surprised, again, this is still true in December. Mm-hmm. Why Does the Earth Give Us People to Love? And God, Dave, you and I were talking about Kara Jackson when she was like releasing just the first few singles. Yeah, yeah. Off of this, including a song I loved called Dickhead Blues, which right. I put on a playlist for my wife, and she was like, I can't play that in my classroom. which is always her litmus test. Like, can I play this around high school students? Anyway, but super just like, I don't know, like a return to a really great storytelling medium, but like from a fresh artist perspective in a, like with some, I guess you would call them like hip hop R&B kind of flourishes within the folk music.
Yeah, I can see that.
Yeah, and I don't know. I mean, I obviously I'm biased because she's from Chicago.
She sure is.
Yeah. Represent. So like she's got that going for her. But what did you? I know you liked this too, right?
Yeah. So I like this record a lot. I love Poncha.
When you become somebody's bandit and their heart becomes your loot, what kind of player does that make you?
Like, if I was doing my top five singles of the year, Poncha would be my easy number two. Like, it is
interesting.
It is my second favorite song that I've heard this year after one that I'll hit in my honorable mentions. Yeah, so she, I found that I was so excited about that song that when I listened to the whole record, I was disappointed. Like, not because it was amazing music, but it just didn't sound like Pawnshop. And yeah, so yeah, I think I've need to come experience. Back to it with fresh ears. Obviously, we've talked about this before. Folk music isn't a genre that I tend to like. I really like her. I love her voice.
Me too.
I love that deep baritone voice of hers.
And her voice, just like in a way that most folk singers... Most folk singers are obviously great storytellers,
yes,
but they're still like, I don't know, they're still like singing song words they wrote to tell you the story. She just feels like she's telling you the story. Like, I don't know how else to explain that, like her, the sing-songy way of her, like quality of her voice and melodies, yeah, but she just sounds like you're like sitting around the fire and she's just telling you a story and her guitar happens to be there and she's just like using singing as a melody to tell you. I don't know, it's a magical quality I think she has, and I really think she's got a great future ahead of her. I'm excited to see where it goes.
What is the best setting to listen to Kara Jackson in?
Ooh, I mean, I maybe I'm biased by recent experience, but I would love to listen to Kara Jackson like around a fire at night, maybe with like close friends.
Okay.
And maybe that's because I could picture her like again sitting down with her guitar right next to us, like just singing the songs to us. I've also had this on a lot on repeat, just like on Saturday mornings in my like normal kind of relax and read time. And
yeah,
oh, it's so good.
Do we need to do an episode where Caroline comes on and we pick the best album for teaching in art class?
Oh, yeah. I don't know that. I think she might be intimidated about coming on to help do that. But, you know, we could do it for her. And then she could come on.
I don't know much about that. Not that I knew much about Peyote in the Woods. But I don't know quite enough about how to even begin thinking about teaching an art class.
Oh, interesting. She could come on and be like, here's what it's like to teach an art class. And then we could be like, great, here's the music for that.
I'm into it. Caroline, you also are welcome on our podcast anytime. All right, so my number two is your number one, so I'm gonna hang on a second before we talk about that one, and I'm gonna talk about my number one album from the first 6 months of this year, and it is by another Black woman named Yazmin Lacey, and Yazmin Lacey's record is called Voice Notes, and oh boy, I love this album. She's been making music the last several years and has been kind of throwing a bunch of different genres and styles together to create something really new and special. I think she has a deep jazz background. Every time I find videos of her performing, it seems like there's a lot of jazz, and all of the instrumentation on this record sounds live. I don't think any of this is sampled. I could be wrong about that. But this record has just got my number. I don't necessarily know if she's doing anything new. Like, this record sounds a little bit like Jill Scott. It sounds a little bit like some Janet Jackson stuff I've heard. It sounds a little bit like some Erykah Badu stuff that I've heard.
Or Ella Fitzgerald. I mean, it's very, you're right. It's like, it's got clear jazz roots for sure.
But I think her voice and vibe and style brings out something in this music. So first of all, the music, just like the beats and the bed of sound that she has helped create or has created herself, is really cool. Like, it's just cool. Like, I put this on and I feel cool listening to it. It has that kind of like 90s Jill Scott throwback thing, you know, where there's a lot of jazz notes, but there's also a ton of hip hop embedded into it. And it's all kind of fleshed out through an R&B lens. But her voice, which is not like soaring, she's not like aiming for crazy runs and thrilling high notes or whatever. She actually lays back in the mix quite a bit. I find something that I always enjoy listening to this record is how often she gets behind the beat just a little bit. On purpose, obviously, she gets behind the beat just a little bit to where the way that she's delivering the songs doesn't sound exactly like how I would anticipate, you know, just any standard person singing this music to present it. She's not necessarily, she doesn't have a big flashy voice, but she has a really, really deep, lush voice. And what she's doing with her voice is incredible. I think that this music is just coherent, cohesive, feel like annoyingly, like technical terms for the thing that is my number one album of the year, but this record start to finish is a vibe. And it is more than most things I've listened to. I just enjoy putting it on. I put it on when I'm making breakfast. I put it on when I'm making dinner. I put it on when I'm sitting out on my back deck. I put it on when I'm driving around town. I have listened to this album so much this year, and it's just really easy to listen to. It has kind of that, you remember that first episode where we come back to this a lot, like, you put on Mariah Carey's Fantasy and you're in the mood for it, regardless of what was happening before hearing those notes. I have discovered that this is an album like that, where if I put it on, I'm in the mood for it. And I think what might be true is at the end of the year, it might not be my number one anymore. It doesn't feel like it's necessarily going to be in my rotation for the next 10 years. But if it is, I won't be shocked, because it is so good. And so there's so many new things to discover every time I listen to it. Her vibe is just one of my favorites that I've heard in the last several years. I'm really excited about this album. I'm really excited about this artist.
So and potentially canon worthy, but you're not sure yet.
I think that's right. This is as close as I've come to that Caleb, let's pick a 2023 album as a best album for something thing.
Oh, yeah.
This feels like it could be actually the best album for several scenarios in my life. And if we are still doing this podcast 2 or 3 years from now, it'll absolutely be a pick for one of those.
Nice.
Yeah. She's great. Have you listened to this?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, definitely. I listened to it when it came out. And then when you were telling me how much you were vibing with it, I put it back on and I agree. I really liked this. It definitely showed up in my honorable mentions. I don't think I listened to it quite enough to make the top five, but super fun album. And like, what I'm realizing is that a lot of the artists that you and I and like have put in the top five, again, going back to that genre question, or like genre bending or like doing really interesting things with their voice, doing really interesting things with you know, their mix of different things that you wouldn't expect on their albums. And I think that's a common theme. And this is one of those that is surprising in so many delightful ways.
Yeah. Yeah, man. I love this record. I could talk about it for an hour with you, but we should talk about your number one, my number two. Tell us what it is.
Yes, it is Eve Tumor, Praise a Lord Who Chews, But Which Does Not Consume, which is such a mouthful. It's like consuming the album title itself.
I love that there's actually a parenthetical at the end of this album title, or simply Hot Between Worlds.
Right, right. Well, I think you and I both really loved their first album too, right? Or not first,
well,
last
I don't know.
Album.
I've loved their last couple albums, yeah.
Yeah. I was introduced to Eve Tumor through their last album, which was Heaven to a Tortured Mind, I believe. Mm-hmm. And just found their, you know, mix of R&B, alternative, experimental, like just, again, genre bending to be really appealing. But then, oh man, I saw them live this year and that cemented it for me. I was already anticipating this album coming out after their last one. Loved the first couple singles. Then it came out. I was listening to it. Loved it. Then we went and saw them live. And oh, man, they were so much fun live. And then because I saw them live, And I don't know if you have this experience when you see an artist live that you, then you like end up like listening to the music again to kind of relive that experience. If it was a great kind of live show, and I started doing that, and I think it really like solidified this album as a you know, in the top for me for this whole year. I would be surprised if this wasn't in my top five come end of year for sure.
I have a very different experience with concerts, just to go on a slight little tangent here. For me, concerts are often a culmination. And once the concert is over, I tend to like fall off.
We've talked about this. For you, it's like a payoff, and then you're like, okay, on to the next thing.
Yeah, yeah. I'm sad I didn't get to go to that concert, and also maybe it's for the best because I'm going to listen to this all year.
Yeah, I think I intentionally don't go deep on the artist before the concert
because you don't want spoilers.
Yeah, so they can like surprise me, and then I go deep after. Dave's like looking at me like this is the wrong way to do concerts.
It's the wrong way to do life, do music. Good grief. So I was really into a 2018 record that they put out called Safe in the Hands of Love. It was actually really high on my year end list that year. But that record is very different than this one. That one is much darker, much more sinister. It doesn't have that kind of poppy melody quality that is all over this one. I found that on Heaven to a Tortured Mind, they were going more towards that pop melodic thing. And I actually didn't like it as much. I was a little like,
interesting.
I was sad that it didn't sound like Safe in the Hands of Love because I was so excited about that record. But this one feels like it brings all those things together. Like he has that same kind of like, you know, pure melody on top and then doing all sorts of interesting things with those melodies underneath. But it's in service of something that sounds a little haunting, maybe like a little, I don't know, like sultry. Like, I don't know what the right word is exactly here, but I just really, really respond to this record. I think that it is the first thing I've heard in a couple years where I had an experience of, "Ooh, what is this? Like, this feels new. This is a new thing that I'm listening to." There's a moment on, I think I talked about this in a previous episode, but there's a moment on a song called Meteora Blues, which is a pretty chill song, but it has these like moments of cacophonous walls of sound that's like kind of shoegazy, Smashing Pumpkins, Siamese Dream era sound that of course is like my favorite thing in the world. And the thing that I most miss in modern music is that nobody makes music like that anymore. And he erupts into these explosions of sound. Red cherry lips, thought I found me in my dream. Never know where the explosions are going to happen. It feels like this is kind of this weird volcano that could pop off in any moment. And as you kind of settle into a groove, suddenly it can just take a turn and it's thrilling. Like it feels like you're on a real journey through this whole record and every song is better than the last. It's so cool.
It's so fun. And like, I think we should talk about our entry point. I mean, I think I would start, I mean, God is a Circle. Just the intro is so unique and so memorable. I mean, just start the album. I remember the first time I put it on, I was like, "Oh yeah, already into this. This has caught me. This is fun."
Yep.
But probably Echolalia is my favorite track on it. It's so dancey. It's so fun. Like it's a groove. I kind of like, if you're not familiar with Yves Tumor, how would you describe them? I would kind of describe them as like a black queer David Bowie, maybe.
Oh, I
like,
could see that. You,
yeah, sure. Right?
It's ironic that Sean Bowie is Yves Tumor's actual name.
Oh, that's right. I didn't even think about that. The description in Apple Music of this album calls it subversive. This is my best description I've ever heard of this album. It calls it subversion because they deliver you their weird art and it feels like pleasure.
I like that. That's good.
I know.
That's
a good line. Love it.
Yeah. Yeah. Yves Tumor. So good. What a great year for music. This could have easily been my number one and probably is my favorite album. If I have even a slight critical lens on the Yazmin Lacey album, just has a piece of my heart that this one. But this feels like a record that could end up in my top 20, like all time down the road.
Oh, wow.
It's so good. I think I'll be listening to this for years. It's great.
All right.
All right, so we're going to do some short honorable mentions because we've been going a little bit long this podcast. But for me, I don't have a whole lot that I am excited about. Like, there's a lot of albums that I've really liked. 100 Jacks, Caroline Polachek, the Fever Ray record. Didn't love the Lana Del Rey record, but I think I should come back to it and try again. The Mara, there's a electronic record by Wada Igarishi that I really like. Yeji put out a new record this year. But there is a few that I want to call out and just spend a minute on. One is this lady named Debby Friday, who her album is pretty intense. Like, it's kind of has this MIA quality of intense in your face and kind of industrial, pretty dark. And then she has this one track called So Hard to Tell that ventures more into like kind of R&B, like it's fun. Like, it's a really fun poppy track. And it is my favorite thing ever this year. When you get like this. This song, So Hard to Tell by Debby Friday, is my favorite single piece of music that I've heard this year. And it's only that the record is so different that I sometimes struggle to like situate it in the context of the record. I found myself greatly anticipating that record because of that single. And then when I put it on, I was like, oh, this is not the same. Like, this is, it's one of those moments, like the zombie moment that we had a few weeks ago. It is not the same as the rest of the record, but So Hard to Tell is a great song. It's actually a really great album too. It's just not something that I find myself, it's not as pleasurable to listen to as So Hard to Tell, but that song has really got me. And then the last thing is this, well, of course, Jesse Ware's That Feels Good, which I thought was going to be my top five, but slipped out right at the end. And then this punk band called MS Paint, who put out a record called Post American.
Great album.
That's so fun.
Or great name, I mean.
Yeah, it's so fun. If you're just looking for a 90s throwback, MS Paint is a great place to start.
Like pop punk or like...
Yeah, for sure. I mean, punk. It's more... it's louder and more intense than pop punk, but it's not, I wouldn't call it punk either. So it's somewhere between the two.
Fair enough. Yep. Fair enough.
What were some of your honorable mentions?
I had a hard time even calling the honorable mentions list because there was, you know, so many good things. I also enjoyed the Caroline Polachek album. The other folk albums that I really liked were Sunny War, Anarchist Gospel, which came very close to being in my top five. And then Joy Ladakun put out a great album, Proof of Life, which is a little, I think, probably the most accessible in terms of those three folk albums that I've been talking about. I also liked some like weirder experimental stuff so far this year. Young Fathers, Heavy. Talked about Water From Your Eyes, Everyone's Crush, like stuff that's definitely a little bit more, I don't know, like in the brotherhood of Yves, Tumor in terms of its kind of weirdness, but like in a way that's appealing to me. There's great alternative albums. Alex Leahy, The Answer Is Always Yes. Bully, Lucky For You, which is
that
also
a good record?
Kind of,
I haven't listened to it yet.
I think it's fun. Yeah. Again, not in my top five, sure. But like, would I put it on and listen to it? Yeah, definitely. Also, we talked about great R&B albums. Oh my God, like Kelly Uchis, Live, Girl in the Half Pearl, which is kind of like if Nine Inch Nails did R&B. Like, that's the only way I could like describe that album, which is a love. We talked about how the Belle and Sebastian album this year I was into. One that I wanted to bring up with you that we haven't talked about is the new album by The National, which I actually like enjoyed, I think, more than I usually like. The last couple of National albums I've been like, okay, yeah, all right, you're doing your thing. But you know that like the first few National albums were really special to me, especially Boxer. I think this one was appealing to me more so than the other ones, but I wanted to kind of hear what you think. Like, is that one that you picked up this year so far?
Yeah, I haven't heard it. I haven't heard a single song on it. Isn't that crazy?
That's wild to me.
I also loved The National and still listen to Boxer from time to time. Song Live, and they're amazing. I think that I felt like they kept making the same record over and over again.
Yes.
And then they didn't. They actually made a record that veered off course, but I didn't like it. and so when this one got kind of like like decent reviews, but not like, you know, this is a return to form, this is an amazing record. I don't even know what a return to form would do for me, because I don't want another album that sounds like Boxer. They've done that too many times. Mm. But I also, I just don't know what I'm looking for. And so I just wasn't excited, and I was sad. I was genuinely sad that I wasn't excited about a national record. But is it good? Like, should I give it some time?
I think Bridges you should. I feel like it. Yeah. Phoebe Bridges is on it. Taylor Swift is on it. Don't know how I feel about that, but
hey, man, Taylor Swift is we're not here to yuck Taylor Swift.
I'm not yucking Taylor Swift. I just feel like she is like really trying to build up her indie credibility by like, you know, like collaborating with artists that aren't as much in the mainstream.
Building up her indie credibility by being an incredible indie artist. By making incredible music.
Yeah.
Let's fight about Taylor Swift.
Let's. Anyway, yes, pick it back up, because I, at the very least, I want to know what you think.
Okay.
I do think it's a little moodier than I would normally go to as a... I think what I loved about Boxer is it's moody, but it's also fun, and it, like, has... It's got, like, a range, and this, I think my critique of it, which is why I didn't end up in my top five, is it's kind of, like, it's just kind of consistently moody. And which is, with a... I read a profile of the National in the New Yorker called Sad Dads. And I was like, yeah, that sounds right. So
does it have that driving rhythm that Boxer had?
Oh man. Yeah. The drumming of the National has always been so appealing to me.
Yeah.
I don't know. Okay. I don't know what I definitely wouldn't call it driving.
You know, my bone to pick, I think, with the National is that their sound kind of infiltrated a lot of other bands that I liked, including Frightened Rabbit. Mm. You know, their Pain of a Panic Attack that was produced by Aaron Dresner. It was fine. Like, it wasn't... I'm really sad that it was just fine, because there's a lot of good songs, you know, the kind of beginnings of songs that just didn't feel like they got fleshed out, or...
Yeah.
And it ended up being their last record. And so I think I'm angry at the National
on some level.
Like that, not like angry at them, like they need to be on my revenge list,
all right. But
angry, you know, like I don't, it's not as joyful as it used to be, because
we're gonna save that for best album for therapy.
What is a podcast if not a therapy session between two old friends? Anything else before we wrap up the honorable mentions?
I don't think so. I mean, we could keep going on. Labyrinth, Maiden, yeah. Sorry. Labyrinth Maiden, and are you a fan of Labyrinth, Ends and Begins? Nope. I mean,
I'm not a fan. I just don't know them.
I mean, do you like Euphoria, the show? Because they basically like produced all the music in Euphoria.
I'm not a fan. I just have never watched it. I don't know anything. I mean, the subject matter didn't appeal to me, to be frank.
Regardless, moody electronic R&B type feels. You'd probably
get that. I can hang with that.
Yeah, that's, I mean, there's probably more, but that's plenty for.
Yeah, and we usually end with, what are you listening to this week? It feels silly to do that at the end of this episode. So we thought we'd do something a little different and talk about what we're most excited for the rest of the year. I've got three records on my radar that I'm really excited about. One is coming out tomorrow, and by maybe should have been in my top five if we recorded this, you know, 3 days later. But it's Queens of the Stone Age's new album, In Time's New Roman. I'd really like In Queens of the Stone Age, and I thought that their record about, I guess maybe now it was a long time ago, but Like Clockwork was a late career kind of best album. I think it's their best album. And so I'm always excited to hear something new from them. The Chemical Brothers have been putting out singles here and there, and they've all been really good. The Chemical Brothers, as you'll discover on some podcasts in the future, are... like, I just love them so much, but like all of my bones. And, you know, watch their show on Coachella, and it was so exciting and so thrilling. And all the new stuff they've been putting out this year is really, really good. So if they have a new record coming out, that is highly anticipated. But my most anticipated is this new record by Royce and Murphy called Hit Parade that's going to come out in September, because it was produced entirely by DJ Cozy. DJ Cozy is, as we've discussed, my guy. He is the number one on my list. Radiohead's the number one. Radiohead's the number one on like, if you put new music out, I'm really excited. DJ Cozy's a tied for number one, kind of a 1B on that list. Just love everything he touches. And He's done a couple of tracks with Royce and Murphy before that were some of his best and some of her best. And she put out a record a few years ago that was super disco-y and super fun, but it was released during COVID. And I was just never in the right setting to enjoy a record of like big, fun, disco-y music. And so I'm hoping this year there will be more opportunities to enjoy that type of music. So Royce and Murphy's Hit Parade is kind of my, I'm anticipating it'll end up in my top five, even though it's not coming out until September.
Fun. Well, I did not come prepared with three albums I'm looking forward to, but there is at least one, and that is by the electronic artist Glasser. Are you familiar with her work?
A little bit, but speak on it.
So she put out an album. She's coming out with an album called Crux this year, which she just released a single for, and she's not released music in a very long time. Her last album came out, I want to say, in 2013. Yep. Which was called Interiors, which I actually liked but didn't love. But her first album in 2010 called Ring, I really loved and really defined for me. It was one of the like defining albums of like that couple of years. I can remember doing a lot of road trips listening to it, a lot of airplane rides listening to it. You know, like if we were talking about the best album for decompressing around that time, you know, Ring might have been it for me.
But
she hasn't put out music in a long time, and she's finally doing it again, and I'm looking forward to it.
Nice. I'm excited for that. All right, man, this is a good change of pace. We'll be back with a new episode next week that will be us tackling a real life situation and choosing our best albums for said situation. As always, please, you know, subscribe and leave us positive reviews. Like we said, that really helps, especially as we're getting launched here. And let us know what topics we should be discussing. I told a friend this week that if he said he had a topic he wanted us to discuss, and I said, well, we'll shout you out. We'll shout your name out. And if you want to submit your pick for best album four, Caleb and I will discuss it as part of that record, or as part of that episode. And so we would extend that same invitation to all of our listening audience. If you have a topic that you want to send in for us to cover and we do it, we'll shout you out and include your pick for best album four. And let us know what your top fives are, what records you've been excited about so far this year.